resources.
Just go for it. So in your packets, I think it's going to be somewhere back on the left-hand side. There is a sheet in there that goes over, it says Farm Rental Assessment Checklist, and it was created by the University of Vermont Extension, the Young Extension. And it has a really great list on there of all the things you want to consider when thinking about the layout of the property and what's available, and thinking about how that might meet the needs of a buyer. It's nice on the rest of it, kind of goes into details about this front checklist. So when you think about farms and infrastructure, you know, one of the first things on the property, so you have this barn. Is the barn there because it's just beautiful, but it doesn't really serve a commercial purpose, or is this a barn that is set up to actually be an active operation? And if it is set up to be an active operation, what does the layout look like? What type of animals is it going, or livestock can it accommodate? Is the infrastructure that's in it, is it antiquated? Is someone going to need to update it, or is it something that is just ready to roll? And then, you know, along those lines, like, what is the capacity? How many livestock can be in the barn? Does it have crop storage? Does other silos? Are there feed storage facilities that can accommodate grain bins? How many? You know, is there manure and waste storage? Is the manure storage, does it meet current codes in terms of, are people taking care of their manure correctly? Is there a farm stand? Are there farm offices? Is there greenhouses? There's so many different things to make note of and to be able to share with prospective buyers. You know, power supply. I know there's a farm where there's an awesome field, there's a greenhouse, it all looks great. There's no power supply and there's no water. Kind of a problem. Yes.
Is there any way to determine based on the square footage of the barn came out, how much hay can be stored in there? Do you have like a downgrade formula for that? Because that comes up often. How many bales can this barn hold?
200. I used to know that like 250 bales for so many cubic feet. But it also depends highly on the size of the bales. Somebody making a 45-pound bale or a 35-pound bale. Used to have that number actually on my computer.
I mean, when I think of, I had horses and I had 45 horses, and I couldn't determine that in the hayloft that I used because it was highly dependent on the bale size.
If
I mean, you can have this, and you can have this.
And so, you know, that's where, again, the property owner is aware of, you know, actually the property owner, then check a couple times every time they ask the property owner and use hotel stays. Able to put between 9,000 and 11,000 bales in there a year. And so that was very useful information to the potential buyer. Same thing with bunker silos or upright silos, or how many tons of silos you're able to put in those. Grain bins. Three-ton grain bin or a six-ton grain bin. Walk-in coolers are another one that has a bit more vegetable operations coming in. Walk-in coolers, in some cases, some meat operations and walk-in freezers. So they can be an asset of interest to some people. Even for some non-farm yards, I mean, these those coolers or freezers out of their apartments.
You know, some other things are more practical. So, barn farm related to house, where is it located? Is it something that could be easily expanded? How close is the barn to the house? Where are the streams and rivers, where's the water sources related to the infrastructure? That's really what I have on my list, Mike.
As you mentioned, another thing just about manure, one of the farms you mentioned is that I had no manure storage. And for right now, with the lot, you can still field stack manure. But increasingly, there may, depending on how things go in the rules right now, and access and there may be more pressure to have some sort of holding facility. It remains to be seen. I think partly it's going to depend on where the manure storage is relative and the barn is relative to streams and rivers. But right now, it looks like the rules are saying field stack and it's fine. And this isn't just an issue for dairy cattle, it's an issue for sheep, goats, horses. Where that manure is going to get stored until it's going to get spread. It's going to be under increasing scrutiny at the very least. They won't have to be stacked and it's going to be allowed, which I kind of presume it's going to be for the foreseeable future. On the other hand, you've seen these farms that got these liquid manure pits, the change of use in the farm is now a vegetable farm, it's now not the area, and so they've got these liquid manure rooms that are sitting there and have no real value to any other buyer, especially a non-farm buyer. NRCS has put in a number of those around the river. Sometimes people are like, this way. That was something I wanted to mention earlier that I forgot to mention, which is that one of the things to consider on land and infrastructure to be aware of is if there are either nutrient management plans where the farmer or the property owner has had soil tests taken for nutrients and then planned for the application of manure and fertilizer. Because that will particularly that will be useful for any farmer. Am I buying fields that are fertilized or are they totally played out and completed? And we see that a lot with short-term rental hay fields where somebody says, well, I don't know if I got this field for the next year, so I'll take the hay, but I'm not going to put any fertilizer. You do that year after year, you're going to deplete the nutrients in the soil. And so somebody, the next person coming in, whether they're leasing or buying, is walking into a situation where they have to spend a large amount of money to bring the fields back up to production. And on the other side, now the scrutiny, at least in Vermont, is with high phosphorus levels. And even with the vegetable farmers, I was at my vegetable meeting last month, and that was a discussion with some of the vegetable farmers, and they exceeded the amount of phosphorus that's tentatively going to be allowed under the state standards. And so they're not going to be able to apply any organic waste for a certain period until the phosphorus levels have gone back down. There may have entered into Natural Resources Conservation Service, that's USDA Natural Resource Conservation Service programs. So there may be contracts that require certain things. The seller may not think to tell you that there's three more years on this NRCS contract. So this field cannot be tilled for three years because it was put into a program to protect it from erosion. And that certain infrastructure needs to stay in place because NRCS, USDA cost shared. So it cannot, that manure lagoon cannot be dismantled and removed by the next property owner until the contract is complete. So those are important things that you may not think to ask. Are there any current NRCS contracts for nutrient management plans on the property that may have an influence on what can be done? Before I move on to forests, any questions about infrastructure or NRCS plans? The forest resource I wanted to make sure I gave mention to, because here we are in New England, a lot of New Hampshire, two of the most forested states, most farm properties have forest land, and some of them have more forest land than property. And so it's something that should not be ignored as just a bunch of nice tree-free trees. Because when you actually look at return on investment, forest land actually pays back in many other types of investments over a long period of time if there's good management of the property. So properties may or may not have forest management plans written by a consultant forester. If the property is in current use, the current use property tax program in Vermont is a requirement that there's a forest management plan. In New Hampshire, it's not a requirement, but there is, you do get a greater discount on current use if there is a forest management plan. So I always encourage real estate agents to ask the property owner if there is a forest management plan, even if it's not current use, because a good steward of land may still have a forest management plan. And that can be very instructive to a potential buyer, because not only are they describing describing what activities should take place, they're also describing what is the makeup of the forest management, of the forest. They usually divide them into different management zones and management areas by related species and age and so forth. They often in those will describe how much value of timber is there. Look at one property a number of years ago that the forest plan showed that you could take $80,000 worth of timber. This is back when timber prices were really high during the housing. $80,000 of timber off of this property, still meet the forest management plan for a sustainable ecological yield, and still leave a working sugar bush in place. So I was working with the buyer there, and we did the calculations to figure that $80,000 over 3 years would allow them to install their maple operation, the pipeline, and a lot of the infrastructure, barns, and sugar houses, so that was really instructive to them, to be able to look at that plan and talk to the forester about what the potential was there. On the other hand, there are properties where the property owner is logging it all off before they're selling the property. And they may or may not even tell the real estate agent that they've done that. I've even seen it happen where their property is listed in current use, and in Vermont, at least, if you violate a forest management plan, which in these cases they were, they were doing what's called high grading, where they were taking the highest value timber off of the property, violation of the forest management plan, they could get kicked out of current use. But if the property changed hands, and no state forester had been out to inspect it, because the state forester was only inspected every 10 years, if that was not detected until it changed hands, the new property owner could be liable to pay the current use penalty. They would have to go after the seller, potentially in court, to address that. So knowing about recent logging activities, even if there is a forest management plan in their compliance, they decide, well, you know, I could cut this year, or I could cut it anytime within the next 5 years, the plan says. So I'm going to sell the property, so I'm going to cut it now. So now that value of timber is no longer there, at least in that particular section. So a buyer would often want to know that. I was asked a question over the break, which I was going to bring up, which is that it was about maple. So there is still a very high demand for maple sugar bushes. Maple sugar bushes usually identified in the forest management plan and usually has a density of trees that's somewhere between 70 and 90 taps per acre. So recently I was looking at a property, the property owner was not even interested necessarily in maple to begin with, but I looked at the forest management plan and then went out with him and looked at the forest stand. I was so impressed, particularly as a sugar maker myself. So I was in the sugar house until 9 last night, with the quality of the sugar bush. We figured out that there were between 2,000 and 3,000 taps there, and then the economics of what the farm could offer them went up, and they've gotten very interested in sugar. Taps can also be leased out. I'm working with a person who's buying a farm over in Shaftesbury, Vermont, and she's a vegetable farmer, but there's a substantial sugar bush on it, so we're talking about how do you go about leasing it. Lease right now is generally anywhere between $50 and $1.50 per tap per year, which in a good sugar bush can work out to about $50 per acre per year rent. Paying current use taxes of about $5 or $7, it's doing right? You're taking in more income than you're going to pay in property taxes to rent out that sugar. Now, with that said, a good lease with sugar maker that would be really important, it clarifies what can be done and what can't be done, including what kind of cutting can be done by the sugar maker, as well as what can be installed about sanitation, about access, and so forth. There's a strong interest in it. Right now, the bulk price of maple is down because the Canadian dollar is down, and that may drive the price. What happens in Quebec drives maple on a wholesale level, and the Canadian dollar is 80 cents on the dollar. But there's still a strong interest. There's actually a strong interest from Canadians buying sugar bushes down here in northern New England, because the price in Quebec is dictated by a quota system that's controlled by a federation, that's a cartel. And so they basically, you can only produce so much syrup up there. So the last few years, there's been some Quebecois sugar makers who've been buying sugar bushes in Vermont in particular. I wouldn't be surprised if they entered in Maine. They're done, northern Maine, they've been buying quite a bit, but they put 100,000 tax there. And they couldn't, because they couldn't expand any further, because they couldn't get any more quota in Quebec. There are producers here that are expanding, looking for more taps, whether to buy or to lease. So don't completely discount paying attention to the forest resource, whether it's for timber or maple, or people are growing shiitake mushrooms, people are wildcrafting ginseng, and trying to find other crops that they can grow in the forest. So there's increasing interest in those, whether it's growing or wildcrafting mushrooms or ginseng or some of these other forest growing crops. Any questions on the forest piece? I talked a little bit just a minute ago about current use. So current use, I'm curious, how many people feel like they have a good working knowledge of current use tax?
Which they?
They're different. That's the difference. There is a big difference. One of the resources I was going to mention towards the end, I'll just mention it now, too, is we have a landowner's guide to leasing your land for farming, and in that we have information that links to current use programs in all six New England states. In addition to that, in your resource packet on your left side, I've got, you put together the third page of that, it says online resources, web links, and so that includes to the mapping programs and the farm infrastructure, organic status, and also current use programs. When you look at the current use programs, not just between Vermont and New Hampshire, but between all six New England states and probably across the country, they're all different. So that we cannot assume that if you understand the program in one state, then you understand it in another. So for instance, one of the big differences in Vermont is a minimum enrollment to begin with. It's a minimum enrollment of 25 acres. In New Hampshire, it's a minimum enrollment of 10 acres. In Vermont, you have to exclude 2 acres with the house site. So really, you need 27 acres to enroll. In New Hampshire, you only need 1. Now, in both states, though, there are exemptions to the acreage requirement. To say in Vermont, that's not the case for forests. In forests, you need to have 25 contiguous acres. You've got 15 acres on one side of a town road, and you own 10 right across the road, they don't consider that contiguous, so you cannot enroll. But when it comes to farmland, you can actually, I wouldn't worry about that. Oh, you know what? It's this step. Let's go down to the bottom.
I don't think you're connected.
Yeah. This is available online in New Hampshire current use, and I put it in the reference for Vermont, but one of the things you can see on the basics right up there is that a parcel must be at least 10 acres or provide 2,500 in annual agriculture or horticultural products. So that small 5-acre horticultural application that I mentioned earlier could actually enroll in current use, assuming that it's a pretty low threshold. gross more than $2,500 in sales. Vermont has a similar income possibility, which I can never keep in my head because it's a little convoluted, because it's like so much in every 2 years. But we looked that up online for income. But Vermont is also a third exemption, which is it's less than 25 acres. And it's also owned, it's either owned by a commercial farmer, which is defined as somebody who makes more than 50% of their gross income on their federal taxes. So filing Schedule F, more than 50% of their gross adjusted income comes from farming, then they're automatically deemed even if they have less than 25 acres. Or if a property owner leases to such a farm. Now, the law says technically it has to be a 3-year written lease. Unfortunately, I've not seen that ever enforced. I think if the property changes hands, the listers are probably more likely to call that into question. And then the 3-year written lease would be required. If you're leasing to someone, it's that information. Then it would also be.
I'll just add one piece. I was talking to a planning forester in Vermont recently who told me that over the years, the agricultural current use program in Vermont has not been regulated as well as the forest program because there isn't someone on the ground. But they haven't begun to go back and look at all of those in the last year. And as a result, the number of people is pulling out of current use for agriculture. So just beware. Enrolled at one point, maybe they had a sheep farm, they may have kept sheep there for some period of time and they're in current use, but if there are no sheep there anymore, and they should not be in current use anymore, and maybe discover in the next year or so.
I think as long as they have the 25 acres, that would be
interesting. Yes.
So it becomes the more of the issue when you get below the 25 acres. The other significant difference between the two states is agricultural buildings infrastructure. So in New Hampshire, there is no current use for the buildings permitted to the buildings themselves. As a matter of fact, the footprint of the buildings actually gets taxed as developed land. Where in Vermont, you do not get taxed on the land underneath the ag buildings any differently. And if the farm building is either being used by the owner as a commercial farmer, or they're leasing it to a commercial farmer, again, same definition, then there is no property tax whatsoever on ag buildings. But it's important that it's either being used by a farmer as a lease, or the owner as a farmer that needs a qualification. A couple years ago, also here in the Upper Valley, I was working with a farmer. She worked full-time as a nurse, and part-time with her mother on the farm. It was a dairy farm. When her mother died, she inherited the farm. Because her taxes showed that she has got most of her income from nursing, in the first year, the town took the buildings out of current use, and she had to pay the taxes. She didn't have to pay a penalty, but she had to pay the taxes on the barns at full value for a year until she filed the Schedule F that next year, and then she was considered a farmer, more than 50% of her gross income at that point came from the dairy, then she re-enrolled the buildings. So that kind of change is important because they will catch that. There are people can exclude acreage from current use if they want to reserve a house site maybe for a kid later. You'll see that very common. So if somebody had a property in current use, it's best not to assume that all of it is enrolled in current use and to ask, were there any pieces, parcels that were held out? Because that would be important for a buyer who really is looking for a property where they can build a second home or a third home on the property and not have to worry about paying the penalty to take it out of their house. So don't just assume that everything is produced to begin with. Once the property is in current use, it's in perpetuity unless the penalty is paid to discharge the lien that each state puts on the property. So current use goes with the property, not with the property owner. I've seen a number of times where this really was not adequately explained by real estate agents to the buyers. They had no idea what current use was, what the implications were. Since most property listings list a property tax, I've seen many times where people understand that the property tax is only $4,000 because the property is in current use. And that the fact is, if it hadn't come out of current use, it would be more like $8,000 or $9,000. And the buyer is completely unaware of that. There's nothing on the disclosure form that says it's in current use. So I would encourage you, if the working department's in current use, to make sure that that's properly explained. That information is provided in addition to the current use management, forest management plan, and that's well worth it. Any questions on current use property taxes? You had a question earlier on current use. Did I get an answer? Yes, you. I wasn't going to get too much into Act 250 here, but I will say that one of the things that is important is to understand what is agriculture under the law. Because agriculture is generally the production of crops and livestock. And so when you start getting into other activities, it could be on a state level or it could be at the local ordinance level, it may not be considered an agricultural activity. So for instance, there was a lot of discussion about composting. And there's a difference if you composting materials are only originated on the farm versus if you bring in materials from somewhere else, then you become, you're no longer a farm, you're a composting facility, or at least that portion of the business. And so that changes. If you were to do agritourism, so for instance, hosting weddings on the farm, technically you fall under Act 250. It's not, even though we're connecting it to agriculture, it's a non-farm use. When you get into value-added processing, I used to be a farmstead cheesemaker. I used to make our own cheese on the farm. Well, all of the milk we used was from our farm, so it's still farming. If we started importing more than 50% of our milk from other farms, it would no longer fall under the farm exemptions. What's that?
How about hay?
That's the production of crops, so that's
so that's considered hay?
Yes.
In the state of New Hampshire? It's not.
Hay is not?
No, hay is not an agricultural crop.
I'm not sure what that, from what, from a regulatory standpoint, or really?
For current use.
For current use.
Right.
Because there are plenty of properties, I mean, as a matter of fact, there's a lot of properties that are being paid by dairy farmers and other livestock farmers where the property owner has it in current use.
No, but if it's 10 acres or less, that $2,500 agricultural products, hay does not qualify.
So you're saying if it's less than 10
acres? If it's less than 10 acres and you want to put it in current use, even if you sell hay off the land,
so that's from the Department of Agriculture. Okay, that's news to both of us. In Vermont, I know that the income, when you look at an income level, it pay is clearly a part of it. It's production of crops.
I thought it would be too.
Yeah, I think we need to dig into that. That's first.
If you find something different, let me know.
Yeah.
So back to Act 250.
Yeah.
This comes up a lot, and that is where people have been paying. Industrial on this property. So when they go to buy it, they have to get themselves out of agricultural use. And what does that mean?
So that's different. That's not Act 250. That's if they want to build on the property, that's removing it from current use. That's removing it from the current use property tax program. So the land that is going to be taken out of agricultural production, and it's just that land, it does not have to be the whole parcel. They have to pay a penalty. What's that?
Tax penalty.
Well, it's the penalties.
It doesn't have reduced taxes for their use. When they take the production acres out, they have to pay a penalty for taking it out for their use. And it's what it is, it's a penalty for taking it out and removing it from the tax.
What it's trying to do is prevent speculation, right? Otherwise, all kinds of developers would buy it and say, hey, I'm going to get this cheap tax break for years, and then I'm going to, when, you know, when the time is right, I'm going to develop it. And the programs in all these states are set up to make it more affordable for farmers and forest landowners to keep their land open as opposed to developing it. And it's a public good that we've agreed on with our legislators. Is worthy of getting a tax break. And so when somebody develops it, they kind of violated the intent of the program. And so they're not saying you can't get out of the program, but they're saying if you are, you're going to have to pay a penalty. Penalties are different in each state. Vermont just changed its penalty again in the spring in the legislature. There's different penalties. I think both states, the ones that are looking at the entry, it's different for how long the program, or for how long it's been in the program. Vermont, if you've been in Vermont for more than 10 years, the penalty reduces.
New Hampshire is called the land use change tax.
Yeah. I think that's technically it's the term Vermont as well.
Is it not true that, no, New Hampshire correctly called it that, but not Vermont? My understanding is New Hampshire having that attribute, it's more or less by right. I mean, if you meet the criteria, you have it. It does not have to be accepted by the state or voted in. My understanding is Vermont, you actually do not automatically, if you meet the criteria, it's there automatically get your land in your food. So it has to be accepted or has to be allowed by the amount or amount that you get attacked.
This is not true, because this is the application that you need to fill out. It's not automatic. You don't automatically get a tax break on your land. It's an agriculture course unless you enroll in the program. And I have not come across a property that qualifies as a lot that is not accepted. The same thing. You have to enroll. There's been times where they've talked about moratoriums, but they have I don't even know if they've ever actually implemented it. Several times. So we're not going to let people in third use for a couple of years because school taxes are going up too much.
I'm wondering if you were thinking about on-site or off-site mitigation associated with that. In some situations, I think the Randall situation that's been in the news recently where a developer was going to be building.
Could you stand up, please? We can't hear you.
Oh, sure. I was wondering whether the question about Act 250 was stemming from the obligation to mitigate. When you have a large development in the state of Vermont and you're developing on farm soils, there are some obligations. I'm not an expert in this, but this may be what you're wondering about. There are some obligations to mitigate for the loss of those soils and the agency of agriculture gets involved in those situations.
Yeah, so I was going to say, first, if it is in current use, it still has to come out of current use, and the penalty still has to be paid. Then when you go to Act 250, there's 10 general criteria that have to get met around traffic, noise, wetlands, natural resources, and one of them, as I was saying earlier, is primary ag soils. And primary ag soils is a Vermont-specific legal term that groups together prime and soils of statewide significance. And they have a different ranking than USDA, but there's 16 ranks there. And if you're impacting anything that's primary ag soils, it will trigger review under Act 250. The Agency of Agriculture will review the permit application. And the on-site versus off-site mitigation is if the developer decides I can put the development, and it doesn't really matter with Act 250, it's close to the current use. You're going to put it on 3 acres, right? Those three acres that can come out of current use. If that's part of a 20 acre parcel, all 20 acres are subject to Act 250. So as soon as you start to put that development on those 3 acres, the whole 20 acres has to be considered in the Act 250 permit process. So if you said, I'm going to put this industrial building on 3 acres, but not on the primary ag soils, that's considered on-site mitigation, because what you're doing is saying, I'm setting aside, I am not going to develop, and one of the conditions of the permit is that you will not develop or impact those primary ag soils. But if the development is going to impact those primary ag soils, and someone's going to take it out of production, that's where it gets the peg talking about paying a penalty. So, or paying a fee, and that's for off-site mitigation. So that's development fees that will have to be paid before the permit will get issued, and then that goes to the state of Vermont, which actually gets used towards paying to buy conservation easements on other farms. It's supposed to be used in the same geographic area. So if you were to do something in the White River Junction area, in theory the state would try to use that money to conserve other farmland in Windsor County, or northern Windsor County, possibly, or southern Orange County.
One other thing, some of the towns have their zoning set up so that they can have their agricultural soils too. So that may be something we want to look at in the planning process.
So are you saying that there's some local ordinances that sometimes will protect in their planning and zoning agricultural land? I'll give a concrete example. Westminster, Vermont, across from Walpole, they have, along the Connecticut River, they have an ag overlay, which says that I think it's no more than 20% of a given parcel can be developed. The remaining 80% has to be kept in agriculture. Easement or no easement. So that's specific. On the other hand, we're talking about regulations. There are some towns that will regulate some of these when it's not the purview of the state, if they have some say in regulating some sort of agricultural activity or related ones such as value added, the property may still have to go through some sort of local permitting process or local zoning process. I was at a meeting recently where Shelburne, Vermont, had rewritten a whole bunch of their zoning areas to recognize that all these farms were doing value added and doing agritourism and such, so that it was going to make it easier for them to go. It was going to make it easier for the planning board and the zoning boards to know what to do with these scenarios. Not all towns are making that kind of effort.
All right, so I'm going to talk just a little bit about right of ways. Two ways. One, does a property owner actually have the right of way on their land and need to be thinking about what does that mean for them in terms of a neighbor accessing, using their road in order to get to their land, or are they relying on accessing part of their property through a right of way that's on somebody else's land? And then, so I guess, you know, you need thinking about if there is a right of way, how is it defined? What are the restrictions? How accessible is that right of way to the person? Are there any utility right of ways that are on the property? I'm thinking one of the landowners that I'm working with has two properties that abut one another, and his understanding was that the right of way through another property that he would be able to access anytime. And the neighbor has informed him that he's allowed to access the property using his road once a year. That's a huge discrepancy, right? So they are in court right now trying to figure out how often they're going to be able to access the land for using the neighbor's road. So it's something to bear in mind and make sure that you understand what the right of way means. Existing leases with other farmers, is it a verbal lease? Is it a written lease? Will a lease continue on after, let's say, a landowner sells the farmers on the property, is that going to, do the lease continue when the next property owner comes in? So, I guess I was thinking about a farmer that Heck and Mike are working with, who... It wasn't? Oh, sorry, I thought it was. Mike anyways. It's a dairy farmer and... Heck wasn't pumped, right? Yeah, that's a tough story. So he's a dairy farmer, but in order to run his operation, he actually relies on leasing a lot of land that surrounds his property. And this is a farm that has been in his family for generations, and they have verbal agreements that he can use all these fields that are around his farm. He's now at an age where he's getting ready to retire, and he's going to have to transfer the farm to a new farm owner. So at some point, when the farm sells, new farm owners are going to come in. And the question is, this new, you know, farmer, is he still going to be able to lease all those lands? And so Mike has been working with him on going ahead and making sure that he talks with all of the different property owners and changes those verbal agreements into written agreements that will be transferable when the next farmer eventually comes in and buys the property, so that the new person is going to be able to have the same ability to use the fields as he currently does.
It depends on the property owner. So, you know, in one case, the property owner was in his 80s. Said, well, I'll give it to my grandsons. I don't want to do it. So the next step was to start talking to grandsons, who are actually really thrilled about it. So they're starting conversations about how they're going to do it. We found out that they might be interested in serving their families as well. So it really depends on the individuals and what their long-term plans are. In this case, the person's 80, so. His 80s, and so he's like, I'm trying to next year figure that out. So the planning that we work on, farm transfer planning, sometimes this planning needs to be done by other people that are owning these other parcels. They haven't had enough family conversations yet that need to happen and figured out their wills and figured out what they want to see happen. And sometimes it can be a real mess when the person passes on and then siblings are disagreeing about what happens. So then the farmer can be caught in the middle of that. If there's not a written lease that provides for it.
It's a critical decision or a critical discussion that needs to happen, though, because to keep that farm viable, a farm that has been productive and viable and economically for one farmer may rely on access to all of those other pieces. Pay a lot of attention to
Michael
as well.
The example I thought you were giving.
Well, I'm going to have another one, but do you want to say yours first?
The one I was going to mention. I worked with a farmer a few years ago. I helped him get a lease. Again, we're not attorneys, but we help people craft a lease to get an attorney ready. Lawyer ready, and I worked with him on a lease on a property where the person was growing vegetables and strawberries for multiple years. So we had a five-year lease with the property owner. 2 years into it, the property owner decided to list the property for sale with the real estate agent. The property went on the market, some people who were down the road acted on going to buy it. And the property owner came to the farmer and said, well, I've got a contract for sale on this property, and so you're going to need to be out by the end of the fall. And I thought, we've got 2 more years after this year on this lease. And it was a written lease, but apparently, we've seen this happen too often. The owner at first was so excited to have somebody using his land, and he really liked the idea of it, and I'm so excited to see the plants out there getting used. Or that the cropland getting used for growing strawberries and these other plants. And so he just I don't know if you just sign the lease without looking at it or without really reading it, or, but he described it kind of like the lease didn't exist. And part of it was that the buyers were interested in building a house that fall. And so I double-checked the lease, because we had clauses we commonly have inserted into most of our leases that say that the lease will be bearing on heirs, successors, assigns, and agents. So that if the property does change hands, that the lease continues with the tenant, with the property, not with the ownership. And that can happen. It can be really important in these cases where, you know, the 80-year-old person I was talking about, they die, and then it's contested will. We've seen that happen. They're siblings fighting. And so there's you know, many reasons besides a sale why protect the interest of the farmer and make sure that it's a 5-year lease. They're going to be there for 5 years no matter who owns it. Could be someone who has a stroke. Now they've got some of their power attorney working with them. They don't get along with the farmer. So they're trying to tell them, oh, I've got to kick you out. You've got to violate the lease. So that clause was in there. And so the next thing I said to him is, has the property owner disclosed this information to the real estate agent? So I knew full well what would happen once the real estate agent. So I said that, and they brought it back to the property owner, who was trying to tell them not to talk to anybody about this. You're not going to tell your real estate agent where to. So the real estate agent, he did tell the real estate agent, the real estate agent did what they were supposed to do, disclosed that to the buyer, was back to negotiating today. The buyer actually stuck around, the buyer couldn't build their house that fall because the person still had their strawberries, the strawberry plants there. But the farmer was able to finish out their lease. Property owner was still able to sell the property, and the buyer was still able to buy the property, and they had the house on some of that miscarried bond sales. But the point is that I don't think the real estate agent ever thought to ask, oh, I see there's crops growing there. Who's growing that? Did you have a written lease with them? And it wasn't until there, and it actually got in the middle of the sales contract, which was a really messy time bring that in, that they actually, that was ever disclosed to the real estate agent.
That was my story. This story, you probably told it better. There we go. So, our last category for putting together break, existing conservation easements. I really gonna leave all the nuts and bolts of this to peg. I'm just going to, at this point, mention how important it is to know what, if there are any easements, and what those easements mean. I know I have personal experience of when I first moved back to New Hampshire, I wanted to buy a horse property, and it had a conservation easement on it. As it turns out, it was not an agricultural easement. I actually made a down payment on this property contingent on actually understanding, because at the time the real estate agent didn't know what the easement meant. And I'm like, well, I want this property, but it depends on what we find out, and I want to be able to clear some land and be able to set some fencing and shelters. And as it turned out, I wasn't able to do that with this particular easement. It also meant that in this case, the public had the right to come on the property and walk parts of it, and myself at the time, we did not like the idea of him right now, and, you know, he's getting up on a Sunday morning and going to look out over the land that anybody could be strolling around out in the, what would be like across the way from the house. So, you know, that didn't work out for us, and it, we needed to know that before we actually were willing to buy the property. You know, that being said, in the work that I have been doing as a field agent, it seems like there are a lot of really wonderful opportunities that easements can provide to farmers and to future buyers. And I think that's what Peg is going to go into after we take another little break. And she can talk to you about what they mean and how they can be useful.
So, as Carrie said, we're going to take a break now and we'll come back to conservation. If there's any other questions on any of these other legal issues that we were talking about,